Well, I want to tell you it's truly a pleasure and a blessing to have an opportunity to come out here and visit with you guys and get a chance to introduce our distinguished speaker here. I'm Tony Hill. I'm from Southern California. I'm a Texan by way of California. I went to school in Long Beach, California. I played football, basketball, and baseball. I went to Stanford University on a football scholarship. I had a baseball and basketball scholarship. Ended up getting drafted by the Dallas Cowboys. Been here ever since, and it's been truly a blessing. It was really nice that how I had a chance to meet our speaker over, and he said, Bob asked me, what did I do? And I said, I played a little bit of football. He said, nice, and he just turned his head. So it's all right, you know. So I'm extremely humbled, and I'm gracious to have this opportunity to be up here. But we're going to talk a little bit about baseball and Negro League baseball, and I think that's really nice to have people come out here and for myself to be educated as well. My father would probably be in his mid-80s. He'd probably be about 88, the same age as Bill is over here, and he's passed away. But his love and passion for sports was baseball. And he had a son who was a pretty good athlete, and I was a quarterback in high school, but I was a pitcher and a shortstop, and I played catcher when I was really young. And I had a really strong arm, and I really wanted to be a big-time pitcher. But we had some pitchers that had control, and I had speed. So we had to kind of figure out how this was going to work. And so, anyway, got to the point that as being a quarterback, I became pretty accurate in my career, and I could throw the ball pretty good, and I could throw the ball pretty hard. And so for the big games, I would pitch in our big games, and the majority of the games, I'd play either shortstop or catcher, and I'd play the whole game. Back when I grew up, they had a thing that was called Connie Mack Baseball. I don't know if anybody remembers that, but I played in Connie Mack Baseball. That's what I played. And we had a chance to go to the national tournament in Virginia. And my dad was a huge baseball fan, or a huge fan. As a matter of fact, it's football. Before games, we would go to the park and play catch, or in front of the house. In baseball, we'd go to the park, I'd pitch, he'd catch, he'd pitch and I'd hit. It was one of those scenarios that we were just really close, and that was just part of the program. A guy that grew up right down the street from you, if you guys are really big baseball fans in a contemporary basis, you'd understand, you remember a guy by the name of Tony Gwynn played. He grew up right down the street from me, and then when I was at the park, he was at the park. And obviously, he excelled to great levels in a baseball, and I was fortunate in a football. But going back to my father over here, this perhaps might explain why I didn't play baseball, is that we were playing in the championship game. As a matter of fact, it was the last game. The winner went to Virginia for the Little League playoffs to represent the United States, the United States in the tournament. And so I had what you call, I had a smoker. I had heat. I could throw the ball. I had smoke. But I was a little wild. But I could throw heat, and I was pretty darn good. And I had a curveball. At that time, we had only three pitches for me. Oh, actually four. I had a changeup, I had a curve, I had what was called a drop, and I had a fastball. Majority of my pitches were the fastball and the curve. And my dad was a guy that would sit in the stands. When he'd sit in the stands or behind the plate, he'd be behind the backstop giving me signals. The worst kind of coach you ever want to have. He's over there, give me one for fastball, two for curve, three for drop, and four for changeup. We never saw changeup, and I probably should have listened to him this one particular time, but no, I didn't. We were up. It was a seven-inning game. It was a seven-inning game. I struck out 18 batters, and we lost 2-1. I walked about two batters. We're in the top of the sixth inning. I had two batters out. I'd already walked one batter, and I hit another batter, so I had a batter on first and second. And I had an 0-2 count, and had a guy on first base, and I picked him off. I mean, it was one out. I picked him off, so now it was two outs, and I got an 0-2 count. My dad's been giving me signals, and I've been kind of following, but at this particular time, it was a big game, and all the girls in Long Beach were there, and I was 15 years old, and this was the biggest thing that ever happened to me, and I could be really a star if I struck this guy out. I'd already struck him out once. I figured it'd be no problem at all. Generally, with an 0-2 count, that next pitch is not even close to the plate. But no, my dad gave me the one, the catcher gave me the one, and I said, I don't like that. I mean, he gave me the curveball outside. I said, I don't like that ball. He says, gave me the changeup outside. I didn't want it. He gave me the fastball reluctantly, and I said, fine. So I got on my stretch, and I came down. I checked out the runner on second base. I reached back. My dad's thinking I'm throwing a curveball. I come over the top, fastball, outside corner, the guy hits it out the park. We were up 1-0 at that time. We ended up losing 2-1. That was the worst trip in my life ever with my father. So I just thought I would share that with you and my family. My mom didn't know how to talk to my father, and my father didn't have no clue of how to talk to me, and I had no desire to say anything to him. So anyway, I just thought I'd share that about my baseball experience. I had a really good career. I had a career average of about, I think it was 378, so I batted really well. I hit the ball really well, and I was really fortunate. And I really loved basketball. I ended up going to Stanford University and had an opportunity to play baseball at Stanford, but Stanford was too much like a professional team. They were running too much. I thought football was enough running, and I stayed at football, and I was fortunate and ended up becoming a Dallas Cowboy. In closing, from that particular standpoint, the great thing about it, I wore number 12. In high school, I idolized Roger Staubach, Joe Namath, a guy by the name of Paul Warfield, and I get a chance to come to the Dallas Cowboys, and the first person I meet was Roger Staubach, my idol. So life is good, God is good, and I'm just blessed to have an opportunity to be here. So I just want to say thank you for that. With that being said, though, you know, we're talking about Negro League baseball, and what is really great about this scenario today, it's educational. It's a great opportunity for me as being a black individual and generating knowledge and just some history about really what took place back in that day. And I see a mixed crowd in here, and I think it's always awesome to be able to find out about our heritage and about what things are happening in the country today. And so I want to talk a little bit about it, then I introduce our distinguished speakers, as well as Bill McCrary over here, which is truly an honor to have a guy from the Negro League over here who's probably familiar with some of the notes that I have and probably can articulate and maybe authenticize some of the things I say. They may not be all accurate, but it's what I read and perhaps Bob can shine some light, but Bill, without a question, can make sure that those are true. So in the 1880s, Moses Fleetwood Walker, he was the first African-American baseball player to play professional baseball. And that was in the 1800s. Shortly after that, in about 1889, they kicked him out of the league. They said they didn't want him to play anymore. They didn't want any Negroes or any people of color playing professional baseball. And so as time passed on and went on into the 1990s, 1890s into the early 1900s, Negroes started playing baseball, and they started playing baseball together, and they had formed their own leagues and et cetera. And there was a guy by the name of Andrew Rube Foster, as from understand, in the early 1900s, and Bob, you can most certainly authenticate this, is that he was, at that time, probably the best African-American pitcher in the early 1900s. He founded the Chicago American Giants. He organized the Negro National League in 1920, and he was known as the father of black baseball. I mean, so he was a guy that was who pretty much got Negro baseball formed. I mean, he was with the Chicago American Giants. They were an awesome team, and so he did a great job. But some of the things about the Negro League is that there were some great players, and that's what Bob's going to talk about. He's going to kind of make put together a simulation where how they may have formed against, at that point in time, white baseball players in the Major League Baseball. But he's just talking about all the great history that exists. And so we talk about Babe Ruth being an outstanding and great player, and there's no question, without a question, if you can point to a place and say you're going to hit it out, that's greatness. There's just no question about that. Well, they had, in the Negro League, they had a guy by the name of Josh Gibson. He was called the Black Babe Ruth. And he said, you know, he died of a broken heart. You know why he died of a broken heart? He died at 35. He never had an opportunity to play professional baseball. And that was his longtime dream. And he was a guy that was almost like Babe Ruth. He'd tell you it's going to go out. It was guaranteed it was going out, if not then, sometime during the game. And another guy, another outstanding ball player that Bill McCrary was talking to me about is Satchel Paige. I mean, here's a guy who was such an awesome pitcher during his era. I'm going to tell you how good this guy is. This guy was so good that at age 42, that was his first year into the league. the pitch at age 42. Now imagine that you're playing against 20 years old, 30 years old. You come into the league at 42 with one of the most, over 5,000 strikeouts. I mean, this guy had an incredible history behind him, but he made it into the major league. Just to give you some insight of some of the talent that was missed and misled during that era. So Satchel Paige was so good in the Negro League that when they would play, he would say, you know, he said he would tell the infielders to come on in and I'll just pitch it. If they get in the outfield, so be it. Otherwise, I'm going to strike you out. He was really that good. And then they used to have games against the Major League Baseball where the two play, they played together. They used to have the Negro All-Star team would play against the Major League All-Star team, and he would clamp down and really perform and show what he was capable of doing to let you know that he just really wasn't a show, which the Negro League was a lot. They had a lot of guys that were showmen out there who had a lot of fun and were very athletic, but he was the one that made things happen. Now, with that being said, and again, I know you're not here to hear me speak, I'm just going to share a little bit more about Negro history, about some of the ball players. But during that era, when Satchel, and the reason they didn't get a chance to perform, is that at that time there was a guy named Kennesaw Mountain Landis. He was the baseball commissioner in the 1940s. He was a segregationist, and he wasn't interested in having black performers. And so during that era, he didn't allow blacks to have an opportunity to play professional baseball. Shortly after that, in the mid-40s, if I'm not mistaken, he passed away and another commissioner came on board. And with the grace of God and having a gentleman by the name of Branch Rickey and Bill Vecht, Branch Rickey ended up bringing on, well, he was one of, everybody remembers, he was the one with the Brooklyn Dodgers that hired Jackie Robinson, who broke the color barrier and changed what the game is today in terms of having a no-color barrier on the field, is something that we should, you know, all want to have. And so when he signed Jackie Robinson in 1945, he had already been planning on, even with Landis already there, he had already planned on having Robinson play. He's wanted to find a way to do that. So he brought up the Brooklyn Brown Dodgers, that's what he called them, and he had a bunch of African-American players on that team, and when the opportunity presented itself, boom, Jackie Robinson was there. There's a lot more that took place in terms of the Negro League, and Bob is going to give you a chance to talk about it. But the one thing for certain is that I had a chance. I used to have a company called Legend Sports Promotions, and I gave a lifetime honorary reception to an athlete based on his performance on and off the field. Some of my performers were, if you know, John Wooden with the UCLA Bruins, and also Jim Brown, former. But one of my distinctive characters was not only, and Tom Landry was one of mine as well, but it was a guy by the name of Mr. Cub. Bill, you know who Mr. Cub is. Ernie Banks was one of my guys, and he talks about how the Negro baseball players influenced his life and made him what he is today. Mr. Cub is probably one of the finest men I've ever had a chance to meet, and it's always a pleasure. So with that being said, I'm going to introduce somebody who's going to give you a little bit more history, tell you a little bit more about it. I know that Tom is going to get a chance to do some answering questions with Bill over here, as well as with Bob. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to turn the mic over to Tom. Is that correct? And I'm going to say about Bob. Bob is done something that when I came in the NFL, only one person had done that. It's called, and his name was John Madden. You ever heard of the Madden games, the simulator, putting players in the 80s against players in the 60s? Well, Bob took that from another stand. He put players from the 2000s to the players in the 1900s. How do you guys do that? I have no clue, and I'm impressed. The fact that I was in the Madden game, I'm still overwhelmed. So I'm just going to live with that and have some fun with it. But I think you're going to enjoy listening to Bob. You're going to enjoy listening to Tom, and I'm sure Bill is going to have some great things to talk to you about. Hey, thanks for having me. I work here at the City of Allen. It's always a pleasure to be here, and I'm honored that I was asked to say a few words. You guys have a blessed evening.
Mr. McCrary is one of the last living, surviving Negro League baseball players, and what an honor it is to have him in the audience tonight. Tell us the story. Here's your mic. You got to hold it up to your face. Tell us the story how you got your name, Youngblood.
Well, I got my name, Youngblood, from Satchel Paige. He after I made the team, he called all the players together and he says, now we got some young blood. And that's what they called me from then on. Young blood, Bill McCreary.
What was it like playing with Satchel Paige?
Oh, he was something else. He done what he wanted to do when he wanted to do it. He was the type of player that really would just do anything to win a ball game. He had everything that you might need as a pitcher to play and to be the best.
Tell us how you got into the Negro League baseball and what team did you play for?
Well, the reason I got in there, they had a tryout in my hometown, was Beloit, Wisconsin. And it was the St. Louis Cardinals. And my American Legion coach called my house and asked me, was I going to the tryout? I said, nope. He says, why? I said, because they're not taking any black, so why should I go over there and waste my time? He told me, he says, well, go for the experience. I said, I don't need the experience. So he got into his car, came over to my house, made me get on my bicycle, and he followed me to the tryouts. Well, after the tryouts, you know, they call you to the center of the diamond, and they tell you if they want to talk to you or if they want to tell you what to work on. I didn't go to the center of the diamond. I got on my bike and went home. So about that 6 o'clock that evening, here comes the St. Louis scout. His name was Runt Mars, and American Legion coach. Said, we'd like to talk to you and your dad. So I went and got my dad, and he asked my dad, he says, you think he'd like to go play baseball? My dad said, I don't know. Asked him. So he asked me, and I said, well, I'd like to go play baseball, but I know I'm not going to the Cardinals. He said, well, I'll send you to the one of the best teams in the Black League. I said, okay. So they arranged for me to go to Kansas City. And I went to Kansas City, and when I made the team, Satchel Paige called everybody together. He said, now we have some young blood.
What an incredible story. Tell us about, you know, in today's times, ball teams go on jet aircraft, stay in fancy hotels, and have fine dining, five-star dining. What was it like traveling in those days, and what were some of the places, describe some of the places you ate at and slept at?
Well, I'll tell you this, it's nothing like today. Nothing, we didn't have anything. I mean, we ate out of bags that we got at the grocery store, and we went and played ball. Well, later on, as time went on, it got a little bit better, but not much. I remember when I was playing in a Yankee farm system, we would play a game shoe at all the way from home, and then when we come back home, all the ball players on that team stayed in homes of people that lived in that town, except me. I had to stay in a hotel. They didn't want me in their home. But they would come out there and look at me play baseball and cheer me and everything, but no, you can't stay in my house. And then there was times when you say to yourself, why this? Here's a man that owns the baseball team, owns the hotel, that he said that he put me in, how come I couldn't stay in his home? He didn't want that either. But he wanted me as a ball player. So those are some of the things that you run against. I can remember playing in the Yankee farm system, and they sent me to Fargo, North Dakota. I could stand in Fargo and look into Canada. But they never wanted me to play in their home. I mean, to stay in their homes. It was nice. People ask me today, would you do that again? And I said, yeah, I'd go through it again, simply because it helped a lot of ballplayers. But I can also tell you this, that Jackie Robinson didn't go through any more than I did, or any less than I did. Because when I went up to Fargo, North Dakota, they treated me just like they treated people in the South. My baseball career was fine. I won't turn it down. And like when I was in Kansas City, and the Cubs called Ernie Banks up, I took Ernie Banks' place. That was an enjoyable thing. That was really enjoyable to be able to play at a position that Ernie Banks played in.
Tell us about playing with Ernie Banks.
Well, the thing about Ernie Banks is every day he played one ball game, he wanted to play two. And that was his saying, let's play two. And he was a very, very, very nice fella. And he was the type of person that you would want to be around every day, because nothing never went wrong. Everything was right.
Tell us about some of the others you played with.
Pardon?
Tell us about some of the other ball players you played with.
Well, now I played with Jackie Robinson, Satchel Paige, Buck O'Neill, Willard Brown, and that's another story I'd like to talk about, is when Branch Rickey came to Kansas City to get a ball player, and he wanted the best. He didn't take the best. He took Jackie Robinson. He took Jackie because Jackie had been to the Army, he had been to college, and he had a heck of a personality. But the best ball player that Kansas City had at that time was named Willard Brown. I don't know what else to say about some of those ball players. He had a ball player called Ted Strong that played center field for the Kansas City Monarchs. He also played basketball with the Harlem Globetrotters. You see, it is most of the ball players that I played were very versatile. They could play a lot of different sports. And in the time that I was playing baseball, you almost had to play a lot of sports or you wouldn't be noticed. Now, when I was in a junior high school, I played baseball, basketball, track, tennis, and wrestling. And I made every team that I played for.
Tell us why they chose Jackie Robinson over the best ball player. Tell us why they chose Jackie Robinson over the best reason, ball player.
The reason why they chose Jackie, he had been in the Army, he had been to college, and he had a heck of a personality.
But why did they choose that?
Pardon?
But he wasn't the best.
No, he wasn't the best, but they sent him to Montreal for 1 year, and they groomed him and made him a good ball player. He wasn't the best.
What was his name? Ficky, that was the manager of the owner of the Dodgers?
I don't remember at the time now. I don't remember.
They chose Jackie Robinson. You remember, Bob? That
was Branch Rickey that took him to Kansas, the Dodgers. Jackie Robinson was a good ball player. Now, there's no question about that. But he didn't have none of the what they made a second baseman out of him, and the best ball player that the Kansas City Monarchs had at that time played second base. It was Willard Brown. He made Jackie look sick at that time. Branch Rickey was a smart man. He knew what it would take for to be the first black in the majors, and Wood Brown wasn't going to be that man.
What a story. Thank you for sharing that.
I want to tell you, can I tell them?
Sure.
I'll tell you one more thing. I don't know how many of you people out there knew that there were three women that played in the Negro League. And one of them was a pitcher named Mamie Johnson. She was a small lady, and they had a big guy at the Kansas City Monarchs that hit home runs, and oh, he was a great hitter. And he named her Peanut. And she took offense to that, and when he went up to bat against Peanut, Peanut struck him out. Yep.
What were the other two?
I don't remember their names now, but Peanut died about a month ago. She was 82 years old.
Thank you so much, Mr. McCrary.
Well, you know, this is the second time I've had a chance to speak here at the Allen Library Auditorium. The other one was for Black History Month, and both times I was honored in having a former Negro League ballplayer be part of the show. And that's really what made my two books come about, was I wanted to honor these guys, but it was an honor for me to have two guys that played in the league, you know, be part of my presentation. So thanks again. Anyway, the concept of my talk tonight is I'm going to tell the story and share some of the stats of a few baseball players who are in my two-book series. Not only the 25 or the 21 players from the Negro Leagues, but I'm also going to share stories and statistics and stuff on about another 20 to 30 major league ball players that are in the book. Again, just to go over what the books do, is it's through game simulation. In the 1990s, I owned a baseball game company. We decided to create a card set because we had customers that always liked special sets. These guys would be in leagues, and they'd like special card sets where either was the greatest teams, like the 1927 Yankees or the 1975 Reds. We decided, let's make a card set of the greatest players, not by team, but just the greatest players over baseball history from 1881 to 1987. And we wanted to have 400 players in the set. Well, about a month before we did that, I had just got a book for Christmas called Cooperstown, and it had every ball player that was in the National Baseball Hall of Fame as of 1992. And I said to the guy who's going to do all the grunt work at the company, which I was president of, I said, all the guys that are in this book have to be in this card set if we're going to have the greatest players. Well, since that included nine Negro League players who were in the Hall of Fame at the time, we were the first game company to have Negro League players. But it wasn't because I was trying to include them, but once they passed that criteria of anybody in the Hall of Fame, and Satchel and eight others were in at the time, we got them in. And the guy who worked for me, who'd put all the stats and everything together for all the players, he says, Bob, I added another 12 Negro League ballplayers. I said, that's fine. And why'd you do that? He says, because we got customers of ours. They're going to want to draft a Negro League team. And the nine guys we got, since a bunch of them were pitchers, I figured we had to add more players. Well, he did a good job in his selection of the 12 that he picked. 10 of them ended up in the Hall of Fame. Anyway, let me give you a little background on the Negro League players and Major League Baseball. There are 56 players from the Negro Leagues that played in the Major Leagues. Seven of those players were enshrined in the National Baseball Hall of Fame, and they are Satchel Paige, Monty Irvin, Roy Campanella, Jackie Robinson, Ernie Banks, Hank Aaron, and Willie Mays. All seven of these players are in my two books, as well as the following Major League players who were former Negro League players. They just didn't make it to the Hall. Larry Doby, Don Newcomb, Minnie Minoso, and Elston Howard. There are 39 former Negro League ball players that are in the National Baseball Hall of Fame. 24 of those players are in my two books, including the seven mentioned above. A total of 30 players who played in the Negro Leagues are in my two books. Let's see if I've got my clicker working right. Yes, I do. Okay. Let me tell you, when I started to play these games, and again, game simulator, this is something I've done since I was a kid. And I wasn't doing it because I had any intention of writing any books or anything. But as I started playing some of these games and realized, man, this could be something special. I had this vision. Now, I believe the vision was from God. I don't know whether it was, but I can say this. It was a vision. I could see it clearly. I am standing at home plate. I'm wearing a baseball uniform. And I'm leaning on a bat, and I realize, I guess I'm the manager of these 21 Negro League ball players that are out in front of me. So I ask the question, how can I best honor you guys? And Satchel Paige, who was kind of in the middle of the group, kind of looks at me and says, Bob, let us put on the spikes and the uniform one more time. Let us play the greatest players over 100 years of baseball history, from the 1880s to the 1980s. And let us play them in their prime, their best season. And let us play them a full season of baseball. And then you write about it and talk about it. I said, Satchel, you got a deal. What a deal. I mean, I get to write about it and talk about it. So anyway, that's what happened. Just to break down the way the books are structured, just so you get an idea. There are 15 nine-game series against the original post-1900 teams. So these are the teams that there'd be eight National League, eight American League. So you've got, you know, you've got the Giants and the Dodgers and the Yankees from New York. You've got the Philadelphia Phillies and the Athletics, the St. Louis Browns and the Cardinals, the White Sox and the Cubs, the Indians, the Tigers, the Reds, and, of course, my Boston Red Sox. Can't leave them out. And the other teams, I don't think I mentioned Cincinnati, Pittsburgh, but anyway, there's a total of 16 of them. Besides playing these 15 nine-game series, which would be 135 games, I decided to take and have 30 All-Star games, 15 that came right after the 135 games. This was with 21-man rosters, each team having six pitchers. So not only does these 21 Negro League players play the great players kind of by franchise, but they also get to play the 21 greatest players in history in a 15-game All-Star Series. And then I actually had a playoff series. There'd be six teams in the playoffs. One of them, automatic seed, is the Black Ball Stars. They're going to be in it anyway. And then the five teams that do the best in the nine-game series will also be in it. So by the time you get done with the book, you're going to find out which franchise, is it the Black Ball Stars or which Major League franchise came out on top. And then we finish with what... You know, back in the 30s and 40s, Major League Baseball players were not rich. The owners made the money, not the players. And most ball players, if they could, would play baseball all year round. Some of them would go down to Cuba. Some would go to Mexico. But many would go out to California. And during the 40s, Bob Feller would put together an all-star team, and they'd play the Negro League ball players, and they'd quite often end up on the West Coast during the wintertime. Dizzy Dean did that in the 30s against the, both times Satchel Paige was the guy that organized the Negro League teams. Okay, what I'm going to do now, I'm going to show you some photos, But I want to review the 25-man roster of the Negro Leagues. And we're going to start out in the outfield. We're going to start with Oscar Charleston. Now, I'm going to ask by a raise of hands, how many people in this room had ever heard of Oscar Charleston? All right, there's a few of you. Well, according to Bill James, the great baseball historian, there were only three major league ball players in history better than Charleston: Babe Ruth, Honus Wagner, and Willie Mays. Turkey Stearns. Anyway, Charleston, as I said, he was ranked fourth. Turkey Stearns was ranked 25th. He was a great outfielder, played a lot of his time with the Detroit Stars. He won four batting titles in the 20s. He also was a power-hitting outfielder. Both of those guys were power-hitting, speed, and great defense, including strong arms. Cristobal Torriente from Cuba. In the 1920s, when the first official Negro National League was formed, the Chicago American Giants won the first three titles, and Cristobal Torriente was one of the key players for that team. Torriente, again, not much of a, is much of a power hitter, but again, great getting on base, and again, great defense. Cool Papa Bell sliding into third base. And I'll come back to Cool Papa Bell here. Let me just tell one of Satchel's stories on Cool Papa Bell is that Cool Papa Bell was so fast that when they were in the hotel at night, if I flipped the light switch off, he'd be in bed before the lights went out. Okay, so that was a Satchel story. Satchel had a lot of stories. Well, one time they're in the hotel, and, Cool Papa Bell gets there first. And he noticed there's a delay on the light switch. So when Satchel comes in, he says, "Hey, Satchel, watch this." He hits the light switch, he's in bed, and the light goes out. Now, even though I make this comment about them staying in the hotel, there were many times when they had to stay in private homes in the black community. And, you know, when Bill was sharing about where he had to stay in the hotel, what I don't think he mentioned it, but when he was the only black player on the team and all the white players on the team got to stay with families. So he wasn't getting the blessing of staying in the hotel. That was kind of, well, he couldn't stay in the families. I'm giving you a reverse scenario that many times the black ball players as a team would not stay in a hotel. They'd be staying with families in the black community because they couldn't. They didn't eat in restaurants. They go to the back of the restaurant and get some sandwiches made. Okay, anyway, so Bell, another great defensive outfielder, not as much power, but a tremendous leadoff hitter. I mean, just because when he got on base, there's no stopping him. And see, Tony mentioned Rube Foster, and you'll hear more about Rube Foster later, but one of the things that Rube Foster did when he was a manager, they had the bunt and run. Now, people in baseball have heard of the hit and run. And the hit and run is the guy takes off on first, and the guy is, you try to hit the ball behind him, and if you hit it in the right field, depending if it gets by the outfielders, and the guy on first will probably score, and if it gets fielded by the outfielder, you should still get around to third. Well, in the Negro League, they did a bunt and run, and the purpose of the bunt was to get Cool Papa Bell from first to third. They used to practice. Rube Foster would have guys practice bunting, and if they couldn't consistently bunt the ball in a hat, they kept practicing. You got major league ball players that couldn't put a ball down with a bunt if they had to today. Well, anyway, they're playing an all-star team of major league ball players. Again, this is after the season's over. I think the catcher was either Wagner or Party, who both played for the 46 Red Sox in the World Series. Bell gets on first base, and the catcher realizes what's going to happen because the bunt's going to go down to third, and the third baseman's going to field it. The shortstop's going to cover second to try to get Bell at second. Well, when Bell takes off, Bell's at second base about the time the ball's getting to the third baseman. So the catcher, I'll just say it was Wagner, goes down to third to cover so that they can get him coming to third. By the time the throw gets to Wagner at third, Bell has stepped on third, and he's now racing home. Guess what? There's nobody at home. So the bunt went maybe 3 to 5 feet, and he scores from first. This is my favorite picture in this group because it's myself, my grandson Caleb, with Monty Irvin. Monty, who was a great star for the Newark Eagles, and then in late in his career, played for the Giants, was in two World Series. He hit .455 against the Yankees in 1951, but the Yankees won. But he was with Willie Mays in 54 when they took the powerful Cleveland Indians four straight. And it was a great honor to meet Monty, who was in an assisted living home. He's since passed on, but he was 92 in that picture. And he kept saying to Caleb, he says, "Caleb, we just love to play ball." I mean, his passion hadn't diminished when he was 92. All right, now we're going to go to the shortstops, okay? Pop Lloyd. Now, Pop Lloyd played over 100 years ago. He played in the early 1900s. Pop Lloyd played at the same time as the great Honus Wagner. And I told you, Honus Wagner is considered the second best player in baseball history. Well, Lloyd was known as the Black Wagner. Honus Wagner said it was an honor to be compared to Lloyd. So if you think that the great major league ball players didn't know how good these black players were, they did. Now, there might have been some of the ball players who were maybe more of a fringe player, or maybe they just had more racist attitude, because there were a lot of white ball players who did not want anything to do with black ball players playing. But some of the great ones said, "I wish we could have these guys on our team." And another great shortstop was Willie the Devil, or El Diablo Wells. And he played, by the way, Pop Lloyd was great defensively, great at getting on base. Willie Wells was the first home run hitting shortstop. He was Cal Ripken 60 years before Cal Ripken played. In fact, the owner of the Newark Eagles, Effa Manley, her husband had owned the team, but when her husband died, she said she could handle it. And she said that Wells was one of the best shortstops of all time, black or white. Of course, at the time, she didn't realize there was also a lot of the great Latino shortstops that were coming up later. Let's go over to third base. This is Judy Johnson, not a girl, and Bill Dandridge. Two very solid third basemen, great defensively. They were good at getting on base. Neither one of them were power hitters, but they were good, solid players, both of them in the Hall of Fame. In fact, every player I've shown you so far is in the National Baseball Hall of Fame. Now, going over to second base, we got Newt Allen and Frankie Warfield. These two were two very good Negro League ball players. Neither of them were in the Hall of Fame, but they were solid defense, and Allen even could hit with some power. Now, at first base, on the cover of my first book is Buck Leonard. I don't know who the New York Cuban guy is sliding back into the base, but Buck Leonard was known as the Black Lou Gehrig, except in the black community where Gehrig was known as the white Buck Leonard. And then another great first baseman, Mule Suttles. Both of these guys are in the top 100 greatest players of all time, and I think Mule Suttles was like 40th, and I believe Buck was 60-something. And here, the greatest home run hitter of all time. And yes, Babe Ruth, I know you may be turning over wherever you are. But Josh Gibson hit over 960 home runs in the Negro League. He also could play defense, but he just a great power hitting catcher. The other catcher on the Negro League roster from the Newark Eagles was Biz Mackey. He was known more for his defense, but he was also a very good hitter. He didn't have the power that Gibson had. And Roy Campanella said one of the reasons he was so good, those two guys were his mentors. And if you think of Campanella, he was a great catcher, but he was also one of the finest power-hitting catchers, which he got more of that from Gibson. Let's take a look at the pitchers. There, of course, is Satchel Paige. The best left-hander out of the Negro Leagues was the half-brother of Andrew Rube Foster, and that's Bill Foster. In fact, Bill Foster had the best record of Negro League pitchers when they faced Major League competition. And the funny thing is, in my two-book series, the Negro League pitcher with the best record against the major league teams was Bill Foster. Now, here's a guy, Bill. Now, was Hilton Smith still with Kansas City when you were there? Hilton Smith, or was he gone? Okay, Hilton Smith. In 1941, Hilton Smith was 10-0 in league play, but when they played against all competition, his record was 25-1. The only game he lost was 1-0 when one of his teammates made an error.
Just a second. Bill, did you know Hilton Smith?
No, I didn't know him.
Yeah, I think that was about the time Hilton was probably finishing up. But Hilton Smith from, I think, 39 to 43, he was something like 93-11. Satchel Paige was on the team with him, but at the time, Hilton Smith was the better pitcher. Satchel was getting over a shoulder problem. At least in 41, Hilton was better. And we've got Bullet Joe Rogan on the far right, Leon Day, and then Martin DeHago. Martin DeHago was from Cuba, and Martin DeHago played all nine positions, and he played all nine positions well. So when Martin DeHago played, he could have been anywhere on the field. Okay, now I'm going to show you four major league pitchers that I added to the Negro League team's roster, and I'll tell you why and how that happened. That's Don Newcomb, who actually pitched in the Negro Leagues, but he was great with the Dodgers. And this is from his 1956 season. He was 27-7 with the Dodgers. Louis Tiant, 1968 Indians with an earned run average of 1.60. Does anybody know who that pitcher is from the Astros there? J.R. Richard, very good. J.R. Richard, who in 1979 was one of the best, if not the best, starting pitcher in the National League. And the next year, when he was on the pitcher's mound, he had a heart attack. But in 1979, he was good. He could throw hard. In fact, I put him in the bullpen primarily with the Negro League. Donnie Moore. Donnie Moore, another one of those tragic pitchers like Richard, only his was even more tragic. After giving up a two-run home run to Dave Henderson of the Red Sox, which made guys like me happy since I'm from Boston, 2 years later he committed suicide, and they say part of it he never could get over giving up that home run that cost them getting into the World Series. Anyway, why did these four pitchers get added to the Negro League team? Well, in my very first nine-game series in the book, in Game 5, I have a game that goes 19 innings. And I used the entire staff, and I said, you know, if I'm going to play a 165-game season, we get into anything like this, there's not enough pitchers. So I took four black pitchers from the major leagues and added them to the roster. Well, here's the thing. Don Newcomb had pitched in the Negro Leagues. What I forgot is that Louis Tiant's dad was a great pitcher in the Negro Leagues, Lefty Tiant. And then J.R. Richard and Donnie Moore, they didn't have any connection to the Negro Leagues. But those were four players I added to the roster. Now, in the very first series in the book, the nine games, this is the only place where I combined two franchises because I didn't have enough player cards to have a Negro League team and 16 Major League teams. So the Braves and Pirates became teammates. Well, the greatest shortstop of all time was Honus Wagner. So he's playing in that first series. And Pop Lloyd, the guy who was known as the Black Wagner, is in that series. Archie Vaughn, who played shortstop for the Pirates also, and in 1935 hit something like 385. He's considered by Bill James the second best shortstop in the period of time I was talking about. In other words, 1880s to the 1980s, any player who, when we created the card set, we did not include active players. Not because we didn't think much of Ozzie Smith or Cal Ripken. We just decided we're only going to have players whose careers were over. However, because of that, I also missed a lot of the steroid era guys. They didn't end up in either of my books. Not because I knew anything about it. That's just the way we did it. And the other shortstop in that series was Willie Wells. Well, over the period from 1880s to the 1980s, those are four of the best five shortstops. The other shortstop was mentioned by Bill tonight. Who was it? Ernie Banks. Which means in that period of time, from the 1880s to the 1980s, of the five best shortstops, three were in the Negro Leagues. Obviously, Banks got into the Hall of Fame based on his play with the Cubs, but he started in the Negro Leagues. So three of the five best over that period of time all had Negro League experience. Okay, in the second series, it's the St. Louis Browns Baltimore Orioles franchise. Now, one of the things I had to do when I was setting up this tournament back in 2011, I had imbalances on rosters where some teams aren't like the Yankees, where I had more than enough Yankees. There are some teams I had to use free agents from other areas. So for the Baltimore Orioles St. Louis Browns, I had a shortage of pitchers. So old Hoss Radbourne, who pitched for Providence in 1884, is a pitcher for that for the Baltimore / St. Louis team. All he did in 1884 was win 59 games. He lost 13. He started 75 games. He completed them all. That means since there's only 73 decisions, that means there were two games that ended because of darkness and must have been tied. He pitched 680-some-odd innings. And when you think of it now, when they start seeing if they can get a starting pitcher to make it through five innings, this guy, and what happens in August? In the 1880s, pitching was dominant. They didn't have the 60-foot, 6-inch from the rubber to the plate. They could actually be moving within a certain box. So there was normally two pitchers on a team. Well, in August, the other pitcher quit. He pitched 37 of the last 39 games, and they said every day that he pitched, his arm was in a bucket of ice before the game, then he pitched, and then his arm went back into the bucket of ice again. And then there's the great Frank Robinson. Now, here's the thing that I didn't realize this, and I don't know why I didn't realize this, but in the 50s and 60s, was the American League or National League more dominant in the All-Star games? Does anybody know? Not close. The National League won over 90% of the All-Star games in the 50s and 60s and early 70s. Why is that? Well, think about this. Jackie Robinson comes up with the Dodgers in 1947. Immediately, who starts to compete with that? The New York Giants, because they're in the same league, and you know they went and got Hank Thompson, and then they got Willie Mays, and then other National League teams would do it. There was only one team in the American League that was going after the black ballplayers. Yankees wanted nothing to do with them. The Yankees were in the process of winning five World Series in a row. They didn't care, and plus their owner was a, I don't know if he was a racist, but he had no desire to have black ballplayers. He waited 8 years until Elston Howard finally made it. Bill Veeck, however, and he was always known as the Maverick owners. The other owners didn't like Veeck. What did he do? He was the first one to bring up a black ball player in the American League, Larry Doby. Then in 1948, in the middle of the year when the Indians are fighting the Red Sox and Yankees for first place, he decides he's going to sign a pitcher from the Monarchs, Satchel Paige. And the funny thing is, oh, by the way, when Branch Rickey signs Robinson to a contract, he didn't pay the Monarchs to get Robinson. He just took him. Bill Veeck at least gave $10,000 to the owner of the Monarchs for Satchel Paige. Well, anyway, he hasn't really got Satchel signed yet, but he's got him where he's under contract, or at least he has the rights to him. And he asked Lou Boudreau, who at the time was the player manager for the Indians in 1948. And as I said, they're fighting the Yankees and Red Sox for first place. Boudreau was the best shortstop in baseball at the time. He was hitting .360, and he was the manager of the Indians besides. So Veeck asks, come up and take a few swings against Satchel. Well, he takes about 20. The best he can do is two weak foul balls. And he says, sign him up. So what does Satchel do from July through September? He wins six, loses one, That helps to get the Indians in a tie with my Boston Red Sox for first. And the Red Sox do a dumb thing and have some jerk pitch the playoff game, and the Indians win 8-3. And the Indians go on and beat the Boston Braves in the World Series. If they didn't sign Satchel Paige in July, they wouldn't have got in the World Series. The Indians haven't won a World Series since Satchel Paige was there in 1948. All right, now that gets back to Frank Robinson. Frank Robinson had been one of the great players in the National League when they're bringing up all the Black Stars. He gets traded to the Baltimore Orioles. His first year in the American League, and I'm telling you, the American League is weak compared to the National League at that time. He wins the batting title, he wins the RBI title, and the home run title. In other words, he wins a triple crown, and it went, I forget how many years before we had a triple crown winner. But he was just one of the great players in the National League, and he became the best player in the American League when he got there. Now going on, the third series was the Chicago White Sox, and one of the great pitchers for the White Sox, this guy goes back to 1908. Anybody want to take a guess? Nobody from 1908 out there? Okay. Ed Walsh, who was known as one of the best spitball pitchers, when spitballs were legal, by the way, that year I think he won 40 games and lost 15. He pitched only 470 innings himself. He was the star pitcher for the White Sox. And we also have Minnie Minoso. And this is another guy that Bill Veeck signed when he was with the Indians, but he spent most of the 50s with the Chicago White Sox. One of the best ball players. In fact, Ted Williams had a lot of kind words to say about Minnie Minoso. He came from Cuba. His first name was actually Orestes. And one of the things he was great at, getting hit by pitch. He'd crowd that plate. Man, he'd end up on first base 30 times a year getting hit by pitch. He could play great defense. He had great speed. He was a great hitter. A lot of people don't know him. I had the pleasure of watching Minnie play a number of times at Fenway Park in Boston. The only sad part was he wasn't with the Red Sox. One of the reasons he couldn't have been with the Red Sox in the 50s, the Red Sox were the last team to sign black ball players. They signed Pumpsy Green in 1959. Okay, let's move on to the next series, which was against the Cincinnati Reds. And here's a guy from 1905. I had never heard of him, Cy Seymour. And I went back to look at what his 1905 season was like. Man, it was phenomenal. The only player in the National League non-pitcher that was better than him was that great Honus Wagner. In fact, 1905 was Honus Wagner's best season. But Cy Seymour was he played about 14 years in the majors. He started as a pitcher and then ended up out in the outfield. But in 1905, he just went crazy. And I'll show you something later about that. Then you got, of course, Pete Rose. And, of course, Pete, great, great hitter. More hits than anybody, but won't get in the Hall of Fame because of gambling. Now, maybe he will someday, but he hasn't got there yet. And I think the biggest reason, if he was willing to be a little more humble than he was, I think he might have got in the Hall of Fame. But he was always Pete Rose, and there are times I think he hurt his own chance of getting in there. Joe Morgan, maybe the best second baseman of all time. And I actually got to see him play when he was with the Astros before he got to the Reds, and of course he and Rose were instrumental in that great World Series against my Red Sox in 75, which the Reds did win. All right, now Bill James, one of my favorite baseball historians, had come out with a book one time that I really fell in love with. Most people maybe wouldn't, but if you're a baseball statistical junkie, win shares was a way of taking every player on the roster and figuring out, and don't ask me the formulas and everything that Bill James used. He had to use different formulas for different positions. But anyway, what it basically came down to is for every win in a season by a team, let's say the Yankees one year and they win 100 games. He had three win shares per win. just because that made the numbers work, okay? So that would mean if the Yankees won 100 games, they'd have 300 win shares. And all it did was break down the 25-man roster and basically say how many did Babe Ruth contribute, Gehrig, and so forth. Fantastic. And he went back to 1871 all the way to 2002 and gave you win shares for every player, every team, and so forth. Well, when I compared Cy Seymour against these four top center fielders, his year, when you took it as the percentage of win shares he got for the team's win shares, he had a higher percentage, not by much, than Cobb's best year, Mantle's best year, May's best year, and Speaker's best year. But nobody's heard of Cy Seymour. I just thought that was kind of fascinating. Because the other guys, Seymour isn't ranked in the top 100 players. May's is ranked third. Cobb's is fifth. Mantle is sixth. And Speaker is 11th. And Cy Seymour didn't even make it. But that one year, he actually statistically, by a small margin, contributed more to his team's wins than the four greatest center fielders. Just that. Now, that's just like a stat junkie. That probably doesn't, none of you care about it. Me, I love that kind of stuff. Okay, now we're going to go to the fifth game of the series where you take the franchise Washington Senators / Minnesota Twins. I know we think Rangers, but it was a second Washington team that actually came to the Rangers. The first Washington Senators went to Minnesota. Walter Johnson, 1913, considered by Bill James the best pitcher of all time. Goose Gosselin was an outfielder. By the way, I'm not showing you all the ones. I'm just showing you a couple of players from the different series. And the other player I'm going to show you over here is Satchel Paige. Why? In my two books, since Walter Johnson, Bill James considers the best pitcher, and he considered Satchel Paige as the second best, and people can argue about that, but that's who he picked. So I decided in this nine-game series, Walter Johnson and Satchel Paige will face each other three times. Well, then in my second book, I have these 30 All-Star games. These guys face each other nine times in those series. They face each other 12 times, the number one against number two. You want to know who does the best? You got to buy my books. I'm not that stupid. Oh, I forgot to tell you something about Goose Gosselin. There's a funny story about him. He was an outfielder. He was a very good hitter in the 20s, but he had a real big nose. And he made the comment that one year when he didn't hit that well, I hit about 270, but I had to look around my honker, I think he called it, you know. He says I'd have hit 600 if I didn't have that nose in the way. Okay, now we're going to move on to, and even though that guy is a Chicago uniform, that's Cap Anson. Cap Anson, this is has to do with my free agents and stuff. I actually have Cap Anson playing on the Phillies, but I do want to tell you something about Cap Anson. Cap Anson, in the 1880s, helped to save baseball in one way, and then in another thing, he did something that was detrimental. But let's talk about the good thing first. There was a lot of franchises back in the 1880s were fighting for survival, and you'd get a lot of leagues trying to, you know, get teams in their city. What he did, he spoke out against some of these teams that were not in the National League to kind of downplay them. But he really promoted the National League. In fact, he probably did something that helped to save baseball. Because if he had all these leagues trying to do it, everybody was just going under. He strengthened the National League with what he did. He also was very instrumental in making baseball very popular in Chicago. However, the one big negative thing he did in the 80s, Tony Hill had mentioned Fleetwood Walker, who played back in the 1880s. Well, one time the Chicago franchise was playing the Toledo Blue Hens, and Walker was the catcher. And so when Walker came out to catch the game, Cap Anson went over to, I think Cap Anson might have been a player manager, but he went over to the Toledo manager and said, if he's playing, we're going home. We're going back to Chicago. So they took Fleetwood Walker out of the game. Well, about 2 years after that is when the Major League Baseball owners, and there's nothing written about this, they just had an unofficial rule. And not written, an unwritten rule, no more blacks. And it was then 60 years before Jackie Robinson reintegrated baseball. Okay, there's Robin Roberts, great pitcher for the Phillies, Andy Semenik, catcher, and Richie Ashburn. Now, the reason those three guys are three guys I picked is that in 1950, I went to my second major league ball game. In 1949, my dad took me to Fenway Park, and I saw Joe DiMaggio with the Yankees and Ted Williams of the Red Sox. Well, the next year, he gets box seats for a Phillies-Boston Braves game, and I see two of the best pitchers in baseball history, Robin Roberts of the Phillies against Warren Spahn of the Braves. Richie Ashburn was the leadoff hitter for the Phillies. Andy Semenik was the catcher. And in that game, Warren Spahn did something that's been done maybe 15 times in baseball history. He struck out the side on 9 pitchers. And as a kid, I was like 8 or 9 years old. I remembered that. But I never ever saw it anywhere because it was one of those, not a major record. I finally found it in a little record book one time. It was July 2nd, 1950. I said, I was at that game. And the thing is, he didn't strike him out like a Nolan Ryan would with high heat. He had a 12-6 curveball that most of them struck out on that. One guy struck out on a ball that bounced off of home plate. Now we're going to, and again, this is another one of these free agent deals. This guy, Roger Connor, played for New York in the 1880s, but he's a free agent on my Cleveland team. And there is, anybody want to tell me who that is? It's another guy who won't get into the Hall of Fame who deserves to be there. Shoeless Joe Jackson. And Major League Baseball may not have him, but you notice Pete Rose is in my book, and as is Shoeless Joe Jackson. Then we've got, is that Lou? I think that's Lou Boudreau. Hang on, I'll tell you in a minute when I see. Yeah. No, this guy's batting lefty over there. I got to figure that out. Anyway. Roger Connor, let me tell you something about Roger Connor. 1885 was his best season in the majors. And he hit something like 380. Babe Ruth, you know, we always talked about, okay, is anybody going to break Babe Ruth's home run record of 714? And finally, Hank Aaron did it, and it's since been done, you know, a couple of times. But whose record did Babe Ruth break? It was this guy, Roger Connor. Roger Connor had the major league record for home runs of 122. Well, Ruth broke it and broke it good because he then set the record at 714. So we've got Shoeless Joe Jackson, Satchel Paige. Yeah, no, that is Lou Boudreau because he's finishing the swing. I thought he was yeah. Anyway, Lou Boudreau, I think I've already told you the story about what he did trying to hit against Satchel Paige. One of the things I didn't mention about Satchel Paige in 1948 when he pitched for the Indians, he pitched before the largest night game crowd in baseball history. It may still be the record. I meant to check that out. 78,000 at the old Municipal Stadium. Beat the White Sox 5-1, complete game, and he's 42. By the way, he kept pitching until he was 47, and his record while he was in the majors was phenomenal. He was above average pitcher, and he pitched from the age 42 to 47. He also pitched when he was 59 when Charlie Finley decided for a special thing. He had Satchel Paige pitch 3 innings against my Boston Red Sox. So, and this was in 1965. Who is the last player to get a hit off of Satchel Paige? Red Sox in the 60s. Anybody want to guess? Carl Yastrzemski, who I saw play many times, and I never knew that. He's the guy who got the last hit off of Satchel Paige when Satchel was 59 years young. And then there's the great Larry Doby. Of course, Larry, you know, came up, was not as well known as Jackie, didn't have that ferocious personality, but I'll tell you what, he was a very good ball player, and he was on the Chicago White Sox 59 team, the 54 Indians, the 48 Indians, so he was in three World Series. Moving on to the next series, the Cardinals. There's Stan the Man Musial, one of the greatest hitters in National League history. Bob Gibson. And then I got Cristobal Torriente. Why is Cristobal Torriente there? Only because in that nine-game series against the Cardinals, Cristobal Torriente played a very critical part. You want to know what it was? You got to buy my books. Or you got to read them. You may not have to buy them, but you got to read them. Musial, I remember seeing him play. In 1948, Musial, there was no player that could touch him. He was that good. And of course, Gibson beat my Red Sox in the 67 series. I don't want to talk about him. But he's good. Moving on now with the next series in that first book was the Tigers. There's Hank Greenberg, one of the two best Jewish ball players. I'd put he and Sandy Koufax right up there. By the way, I did a book signing at Half Price Books in Dallas last Sunday. In my last two book sales, this couple bought two books that they're going to give to Sandy Koufax. And I go, that's cool. Of course, what I didn't tell him is that Koufax didn't do too well against the Black Ball Stars, but I didn't want to say that. I want to get their money. But left-handed starters struggle against the Black Ball Stars. So Greenberg, now a relief pitcher. John Hiller was a great relief pitcher for the Tigers in the 70s. Now, does anybody know who that is? Well, you can read the readish. Mark the Bird Fidrich. See, one of the things that was great about my two books is there were three groups of players in my book from the major leagues side of it. One, all the players that were in the Hall of Fame as of 1992. And then we had a group of players that we thought were possibilities for being in the Hall of Fame because they had great careers. And like players who were not in the Hall of Fame in 1992, but since have gone in, that we had in the set, Jim Rice, Ron Santo, Steve Carlton, and there's, I think it was about 15 others. But we also had 100 players in the book that had that one best season that might have been a Hall of Fame season, but they just didn't have a career. I think with Mark the Bird Fidrich, I think he hurt his arm. I think his, but he was 19-9 as a rookie, 2.37 ERA or something. He was outstanding. But he'd always be out on the mound talking and cleaning little pebbles off the pitching mound. But he's in the book. Going on to the next series is this is the last series in book one, was against the Cubs, and that is Three Finger Brown. He got his hand mangled doing some farm work, but it made him come up with some real action on his ball. And he had the lowest earned run average of the dead ball era, 1.03 in 1906. In 1906, the Cubs won 116 games that year and lost to the hitless wonders, the White Sox, in six games. There he is, Mr. Cub, Ernie Banks. And as they said, his favorite saying was, it's a beautiful day, let's play two. Oh, I forgot. I had fancy ways of putting him in. They get in there twice. Forget about it. And there's Ferguson Jenkins, another great pitcher who actually was a good pitcher for the Rangers. His best season, however, was with the Cubs. And I also found out that a guy who bought one of my books is a personal friend of Ferguson Jenkins, and he had me autograph it to Ferguson Jenkins because he was going to give them to him at spring training. I haven't talked to Fergie. He had one great game, and then he got pounded in the second game against the Black Ball Stars. That's maybe why he didn't contact me. And then great Billy Williams, another great, great player for the Cubs. Cubs had a lot of great players, but until recently, they just had not enough good players overall. Going on, now in my second book, there are five more franchises, the Athletics. Napoleon Lajoie. Now, Napoleon Lajoie is known more for being a Cleveland Indian, but in these two books, we use the best season of a player's career. Well, Napoleon Lajoie, it was his first year in the American League, or the first year of the American League, when he was second baseman for the A's, and he hit .424, which I believe is still the American League record for batting average. Then we have Rube Waddell, and I'm going to show you next to Rube Waddell. I've got a picture again of Rube Waddell and Andrew Foster before he had the nickname Rube. See, here's the thing, and this used to frustrate managers in the early 1900s or late 1890s. There was some spring training actually done in Texas, and the Athletics would play in Texas, and the Giants would have some spring training there. McGraw wanted Foster, who pitched in the Negro League. Well, it wasn't league. He pitched for Negro teams because the first league wasn't until 1920. But he was phenomenal, and McGraw wanted him to pitch for the Giants. He pitched against Rube Waddell in an exhibition game and beat him. That's when he got the nickname Rube. He was no longer known as Andrew Foster. He was Rube Foster for beating the great Rube Waddell. Well, here's the other thing. McGraw wanted to have him pitch for the Giants, but he knew he couldn't because he was black. But Foster had a fantastic screwball. They called it, I think it was an out pitch or anyway, but it was really a screwball. So McGraw asked him to teach three of his Giant pitchers, who were just mediocre pitchers at the time, Christy Mathewson, who's in the Hall of Fame, Iron Man McGinnity, and Red Ames. These three guys, he had Foster teach him that pitch. Well, in 1905, the Giants beat the Athletics four straight in the World Series. The Athletics do not get an earned run. Mathewson pitches three shutouts in the World Series, and Mathewson now is one of the greatest pitchers of all time. I'm telling you, if Foster doesn't teach those three Giants how to throw the screwball, Mathewson may not have been in the Hall of Fame. Eddie Joost. Now, Eddie Joost, anybody ever hear of Eddie Joost? You got to be old to have heard of Eddie Joost. I mean, in 1949, Eddie Joost played for the Athletics. He was the leadoff hitter. He hit .263, but I'll tell you what, how many of you saw Moneyball? All right, well, Billy Beane would have loved Eddie Joost. Why? Eddie Joost hit .263, but his on-base percentage was .426. He walked 149 times in 137 games and scored over 100 runs. And he also hit about 20 to 25 home runs per year. That guy is a great leadoff hitter. And then Reggie Jackson. Now, some of friends of mine from New York aren't happy that Reggie Jackson isn't a Yankee. Well, his best season, as far as we were concerned, was 1969 with the Athletics. Plus, anyway, to be honest, Reggie would have a hard time cracking the Yankee outfield that already had Mantle, DiMaggio, and Ruth. And there's McGraw, who is the manager of the Giants. The only reason I've got him in here with the Athletics is just to share the story of how Rube Foster could have made a big difference with the Giants, even though he couldn't pitch for them. Okay, next we are going to the Giants. I don't know if anybody knows who that is. Mel Ott from the 30s. Mel Ott, great outfielder. Another great relief pitcher. Does anybody know who that guy is? That's probably from 1952. He threw a knuckleball. Hoyt Wilhelm. Absolutely. There he is. Willie. And then I've got Oscar Charleston up there. The reason I've got him up there, in the nine-game series in my second book, where it's the Black Ball Stars play the Giants, it was one of those series. I'm not going to tell you the results of the series, but I'll tell you this. When the Giants won, Willie Mays was the star. When the Black Ball Stars won, Charleston was the star. And the two of them are ranked number three, Willie, and Oscar is ranked number four. And I couldn't have had those games come out any better. I mean, because I didn't script it. I just played the games. And it was either Charleston being the star or Willie. Who's that? Babe Ruth. Lou Gehrig. Joe DiMaggio. Mickey Mantle. And see, that's the fun thing when I was playing these games. Can you imagine if you take all the great Yankees, you put them together, and the Black Ball Stars got to face them? It's a good series. I'm not going to tell you what happened, though. Who's sliding in third? Jackie Robinson. And we got Roy Campanella, Duke Snider, and Sandy Koufax. Just some of the pictures of great players on that Dodger roster. And then the final series, I saved my Red Sox to the end. You know who that is? It's Babe Ruth. The only player who's in my book on two teams is Babe Ruth. Babe Ruth, a great pitcher in the American League for the Red Sox. This is 1916 season when they won the World Series. Teddy Ballgame, my favorite ball player. Now, let me tell you a quick story. We're about to wrap up here. But Ted Williams, when I was a kid, my dad takes me to Fenway Park, and the first game I ever see, Ted Williams, number 9, and Joe DiMaggio, number 5, are up there. And I knew at the age of 7 what my dream was, and it was to replace Ted Williams in left field when he retired, okay? Now, I'm a religious guy, so I'm going to share this from a perspective of, I don't know how many of you know the story in the Bible where Satan asked God if he can sift Job, you know, and to just mess Job's wonderful life up. And God says, you can, but you can't kill him. Well, I picture when I get into Little League Baseball, when I'm now really going to start to follow my dream. Well, I picture Satan's up there in heaven. He says to God, he says, you know what I did with Job? Can I do that with little Bobby May? God says, yeah, but you can't kill him. He's going to write some books for me later. Okay. So, but what happens? I get into Little League Baseball, I'm afraid of the fastball. Well, if you're afraid of the fastball, you cannot hit the fastball, okay? But now fast forward to 1966, Ted Williams is being inducted into the National Baseball Hall of Fame. And Ted says, you know, I was lucky to have played the game of baseball. But the sad thing is that Satchel Paige, Josh Gibson, and the great players in the Negro Leagues are not in the Hall of Fame. This is 1966. Well, 5 years later, after Williams spoke up, Satchel was in the Hall of Fame, and now there's 39 players in the Hall of Fame. Well, here's something where God's got a great sense of humor as far as I'm concerned. I'm down in Dallas last spring, and I'm giving a talk to a black church in Dallas. It was a father and son breakfast. The pastor was just trying to get some stuff stirred up in his congregation, and he asked me to come speak on the Negro Leagues. So I did, and I share the story about Williams, how I wanted to be Williams, and I wasn't Williams, and this guy comes up, this black dad comes up, and he gives me a hug, and he says, Bob, you're the new Ted Williams. Because I am the spokesperson, or I am a spokesperson for the Negro Leagues. And I'm going, well, God, I wanted to be Williams with a bat in the hand, but I'll tell you what, I'll be Ted Williams as a spokesperson. There is Vern Stevens. Now, here's a guy, let me tell you, When the Red Sox in 1949 have Dom DiMaggio leading off, that's Joe's brother. Now, he wasn't a power hitter like you, but he was a good getting on base. And then Johnny Pesky batting second. Johnny Pesky hit like 340 that year, I think. Williams batting third. Vern Stevens batted fourth. Vern Stevens couldn't help but drive in runs. And in 1949, Ted Williams and Vern Stevens tied for the RBI title. Anybody want to take a guess how many runs they drove in? Come on, somebody. 100? 159 each. Red Sox could score a lot of runs, but the problem was they didn't have much pitching. And one of my favorite Red Sox pitchers of all time goes to the 60s when the Red Sox were a bad team. This is before, well, Yastrzemski's there, but it's before 1967 when they finally get into the World Series. But from 62 to 64, to me, the best relief pitcher in baseball was Dick Raddatz. He was known as the Monster. He was 6'4", 260, and he threw a rising sidearm fastball. It's said that Mickey Mantle was probably 1-for-50 against him and didn't even want to face him. He didn't want, and probably struck out 45 of the 50 times. Now, the one he hit went about 500 feet, long gone home run. But Raddatz was unbelievable. One time when I was listening to the radio and the Red Sox are playing out in Kansas City against the Kansas City Athletics, and they have an extra inning game, goes seven extra innings. It goes through 16 innings. Raddatz came into the ninth and pitches through the 16th. This is relief pitcher. You know, relief pitchers now where, you know, inning at the most, maybe two, or get four outs, you know, for a closer. He pitches seven innings. Well, the next night, the Sox get another one of those. Go into extra innings. He pitched seven innings second night. Of course, after these 3 years, his arm was gone. He couldn't find home plate after that. But for those 3 years, he was as good a relief pitcher as Rivera or any one of them. He really was good. He won 16 games, I think, in two of those years out of the bullpen. And that is it, other than if you have any questions.
Before we get started, Mr. McCrary has one more Satchel Paige story. Do y'all want to listen to the Satchel Paige story?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the thing about that was that I was playing with the Satchel Paige All-Stars, and we were playing the Western League All-Stars, which were their next move would be the majors. And we went to, I think it was Council Bluff, Iowa, and they flew Satchel Paige in, and we rode the bus. Well, he got there about 15 minutes before game time, went down to the dressing room, put his uniform on, walked out to the bullpen and threw three pitches. He says, "I'm ready." He walked out on the mound and pitched against the Western League All-Stars, which Ernie Banks was one of them. Seven innings of no hit, no run ball. In the seventh inning, he set us down, all but the catcher, struck out the side and waved at the crowd.
Now that's a story.
One more quick Satchel story. Again, this is when Satchel is probably in his 50s. He's asked to coach for the Miami Marlins, and this is when they're still AAA, and Whitey Herzog's the manager. And Whitey Herzog's out in the outfield, and just for fun, and Whitey used to be an outfielder. I saw him play in the 50s. But he's just trying to throw a ball through a hole in the fence, and the hole in the fence is big enough for a baseball to fit through. And Satchel's watching him do it. And he's doing it from at least 100 feet away, maybe 120. Satchel says, "Give me a ball." And now Satchel's well into his 50s. Satchel makes the first throw. It rattles in the hole and falls out. He goes, "I got it now. Next one, whoosh, right through the hole."
Questions, comments, protest for either both of our speakers. Any questions, comments, protests? Hopefully no protest, but a question. Okay, this is.
What was it like being in the Negro League? What was it like being in the Negro League?
The question was, what was it like being in the Negro League?
Pardon?
What was it like being in the Negro League?
What was the top team?
No, What was it like to be in the Negro League?
In other words, for you, what was it like to be in the Negro League?
Oh, it was okay. It wasn't nothing wrong with it at all. The only thing that you knew you weren't a major leaguer because you didn't you weren't noted as a major leaguer. But we played as good a ball as anybody on this earth in that league.
Any other questions, comments, protests? Okay, back here.
When you said you had started with the Negro Leagues, what year was that when you first went to your first Negro League tryout or when you first started playing, your first year?
See, I can't hear.
What was your first year in the Negro Leagues? Your first
year. My first year in the Negro League was in 1946. That was the year that Branch Rickey came down to Kansas City to get the best ball player, and they took Jackie, and then they took Jackie and sent him to Montreal for 1 year, and then they brought him into the major.
Questions from Tony Hill in the back?
Yeah, I got a question. There was a pitcher, I can't think of his first name, was Donaldson, a left-handed pitcher. They said probably one of the greatest players in the Negro League that didn't make it to the Hall of Fame or in the major leagues. How come he wasn't one of the pitchers that you had on your team over there, Bob?
Yeah, no, I've read about Donaldson, and you're right. He seems to have been a guy that slid under the radar. The guy in my company who did most of the player adding, the players that we put on were, like in the Negro League, all the pitchers that we put up were in the Hall of Fame, okay? Donaldson never got to the Hall of Fame. But it's like, you know, you get some guys that for some reason or other, they don't impress the right people at the right time. But I've heard Donaldson definitely was one of the best pitchers of the Negro Leagues, yeah. There was another guy that we missed who actually went in the Hall of Fame, wasn't in the Hall of Fame when we did it, and he pitched in the early 1900s, Williams, Smokey Joe Williams.
Questions, comments, protest? Don't be bashful. This is your chance to be an eyewitness, to hear the eyewitnesses of history. Bob May and Mr. McCrary, thank you so much.